Hi, my name is Emil. I'm a founder and CEO at Tomorrow Bio. Today, I will talk about cooling, how to do it, why we do it, what kind of procedures we use, and so on. Basically, cooling from A to Z. Now, in cryopreservation procedures, fundamentally, you cool because the colder the body gets, the less metabolic activity there is. If there's less metabolic activity, so if the cells basically work slower, the less oxygen is being used by the cell. And if there's less oxygen used by the cell dies slower. That's the fundamental A to Z logic about, you know, how cryopreservation fundamentally works. Now, at different times of that procedure, you want to cool at different rates. Initially, the second the body is pronounced, you know, person has just died, heart has stopped, body is pronounced, so it's also now legal death, at which time then the cryopreservation team can take over. At that point, the body is still at 37 degrees Celsius. Now, there is some amount of metabolic activity still going on, of course, on a cellular level, but the cells are not supplied with oxygen anymore, right? The heart has stopped, so the blood is not being circulated, the cells don't get oxygen. Now, if that is the case, the less oxygen the cells have, the cells start a recycling process. I've mentioned that multiple times. It's basically an active process where the cell says, hey, I don't have enough oxygen anymore. Let's start self-recycling. That's a normal procedure in the body called apoptosis. It's actually quite important for life. But if the whole body doesn't have oxygen anymore, then of course every cell starts that at the same time, which would then at some point lead to irrecoverable death. Now, you want to cool down now as quick as possible initially to make that process slower, to let the cell, you know, slow down its metabolic activity and make that self-recycling process slower and slower and slower. And then once you reach cryogenic temperatures, of course, down the line, that process and all the other processes, for that matter, have stopped. Initially, as I said, you cool very fast. You cool externally, right? Having ice water flow around the body. You want to not just put the body into ice water, but you also want to move the ice water so that there's no layer of, you know, warming up water forming around the skin. You want to move that away so that there's always maximally cold water around the body, directly on the body. You also want to have, as I said, ice water, not just water, not just ice. Ice doesn't have enough surface area, right? You might get an ice cube here and that ice cube would cool this area, but you don't have enough surface coverage. And at the same time, you don't want to have just water because it's getting warming up after time. So you do basically a slurry of ice and water to have maximum surface area and keeping it cool at, you know, ice temperature. When I say ice temperature, in this case, I mean water ice. Now, you cool externally, but external cooling is not super fast. So there's other cooling methodologies, some of which we employ, some of which are currently research topics. So one would be that you use all the spaces in the body to have not only cooling externally, but also internally. So in our case, for example, we use the nasopharyngeal space. So we have two small tubes in the nose where this area here, the area basically, you know, that hurts if you have a cold, that area then fills with water and gives you another cooling surface, which of course, in this case, is very close to the brain, the part that we are caring much about. We also have a so-called cooling mask around the head, which basically flows water constantly over the head to make sure that the head and in turn the brain cools as quick as possible. We're not using only the nasopharyngeal space, but we also use the so-called peritoneal space. It's basically a space here in the stomach area that is around the organs that you can fill up with water. It's actually a medical procedure under certain circumstances, but we do it to put cold fluid in and then keep warming up fluid out, or take warming up fluid out, put new cold fluid in, and so on and so on, and basically repeat that cycle a couple of times to use the peritoneal space for additional cooling. You can also use colonic lavage, so the colon itself, for additional cooling, or one more cooling methodology. Now, if you have all these cooling methodologies run, these are the ones that we currently use, you can drop the temperature of the body pretty fast. There's one new technology that is currently being developed that actually has been in development for, well, a couple of years by now. That is so-called fluid ventilation, liquid ventilation. We use the lung space, the lungs, to basically put a fluid into the lungs, a fluid that is an oxygen carrier to, on one hand, give oxygen, on the other hand, also to use it as a cooling surface. The lungs have very, very large surface area to allow for exchange of gas between the air and the blood circulation, right? So the lungs are very, very well intertwined with the circulatory system, which allows, in theory, very high cooling rates. Again, that's a research topic, it's not being employed right now, but once that, of course, comes out of research and can be used in day-to-day practice, we're definitely going to try it. And then if it turns out to be a good methodology, we're going to employ it to cool even faster. Now, once you've done that, once you've cooled down, what you actually want to do for very fast cooling is you want to use the circulatory system, the blood vessels for cooling. The blood vessels have significantly higher surface area, especially, of course, in the brain, because the brain is very well vasculated, because it needs a lot of energy. So a lot of blood needs to get into the brain under, you know, normal operations to provide enough oxygen and other nutrients. So you definitely can use that system very well for cooling. But of course, for that, you need to have a large scale access to the blood system. In our case, we use the aorta for it. So we do what is called a median sternotomy, which just like an operation, like in a heart operation, we open the chest and then cannulate the aorta so that we can now, with basically a heart-lung machine, pump cooled fluids through the whole circulatory system. But this, of course, takes a bit of time. And as I said in one of our prior videos, initially, of course, you want to do chest compressions. First of all, to supply the body with some oxygen that is still in the system, and to move the blood in the vessels around to have, you know, always warm blood get to the cold outside cooling and basically move it around so that you have faster cooling effects. Now, if you stop that, you don't have that effect anymore. So you don't want to do it at warm temperatures. Otherwise, you would accumulate ischemia. So you wait until you have cooled down. And then depending on how fast your surgical team is, you do it either earlier if your surgical team is consistently fast, or if your surgical team is a bit slower, you wait longer until you cool down the body, which then would mean if you take the chest compression off, you accumulate less ischemia. Now, once you have done that cannulation, you can again pump that cold fluid through the body and you achieve very, very fast cooling. Now, all of that cooling is basically around the freezing temperature. You want to only go to the freezing temperature of water. At that point, you would like to, or you need to have the highest concentration of cryoprotective agent in the body to, if you now cool down further, you don't get freezing anymore. Don't get ice crystals anymore. Because otherwise, of course, you know, if you now would drop to minus 20 degrees or whatever, and you still have water in the vessels, you might generate ice crystals. So now once you've reached that temperature, now before you go lower than 0 degrees, before you cross, you want to have high concentration of cryoprotective agent already in the vessels. And now you cool down further and further, of course. The cryoprotective agent in our case already comes cooled down to negative 20 degrees. It's attached to a heat exchange where we run a coolant fluid, not water, but a coolant fluid that can cool down to around negative 50 degrees so that we constantly, you know, keep the cooling chain, the cooling basically ongoing. Now, once you're done with perfusion, right now, the cryoprotective agent is in ideal circumstances, all the water, all the blood of the body has been replaced against that cryoprotective agent. You want to cool down further. Basically, you know, the faster you cool is always good until at least a certain point. Now, the cryoprotective agents that are being used, they don't technically avoid ice crystal formation under every circumstance. They only do so if you cool them down quicker than the so-called critical cooling rate. The critical cooling rate is around minus 0.1 degrees Celsius per minute. So you need to cool down faster than that to not have ice crystal formation during the cooldown procedure. You now want to cool down as quick as possible to around negative 120 degrees Celsius, which is the glass transition temperature, the temperature at which these cryoprotective agents then become vitrified. Now you do that with so-called large-scale cooling boxes. These are basically, you know, large, very well-insulated boxes that have a lot of air circulation with fans in them and have liquid nitrogen, controlled, computer-controlled liquid nitrogen injectors. So you basically spray liquid nitrogen vapor and then, you know, in a kind of, you know, twirling tornado kind of thing, move the air around to have the maximum cooling effect. Now, you go down to negative 120 degrees with that as quick as possible. Basically, you blast liquid nitrogen vapor, you move the air as much as possible, and so on and so on. And once you're there, now you want to cool down very, very slowly to the final storage temperature. final storage temperature can either be negative 196 degrees in the case of immersion liquid nitrogen doers, or around negative 140 degrees in the case of ITS, intermediate temperature storage doer. There's another video, check that video out, that we did about ITS doers. Now, whatever the final temperature is, you want to go very, very slow to that temperature. The reason why you want to go slow is because once you cross the glass transition temperature, the temperature where you go into a vitrified state, at that point, everything becomes a solid, basically. Now, if you would cool that solid further fast, then you would get different cooling rates at different areas of that solid, let's say the brain. So the outside, for example, would cool faster than the inside. Due to these different cooling rates in that solid, we would kind of get thermal stress, like tension. And that tension can release in so-called fracturing or cracking, where basically you have macroscopic cracks due to these different temperatures and releasing that stress. Now, if you cool very slowly, you always give time to release that stress. Now, let's say if you want to cool down to cryogenic temperatures to around negative 196 degrees in the case of an immersion doer, you do that for around 100 hours. So you go very, very, very slowly, not even a degree per hour. If you cool down only to negative 140 degrees, which is also cryogenic, it's under the glass transition temperature, then you can do that, of course, also as slow as, you know, reasonably possible, but as slow as possible is good. If you want to learn more about similar topics, for example, what happens to the brain, including the blood-brain barrier and so on, check out our video here. And if you want to talk to us directly, then of course, we're always more than happy to, you know, have a call with you one-on-one or an email chain, of course. Just reach out and let's talk.